Hello, everybody. Thank you for waiting. I'm glad to introduce our today's presenter with our colleagues from Institute of Education, High School of Education, Oleg Leshukov, Daria, Platonova, and Dmitry, Semyonov. They present the joint paper, Does Competition Matter? The Efficiency of Regional Higher Education Systems and Competition, the Case of Russia. So, please.
Thank you. Good evening, dear colleagues. We're happy to present our paper in the Center of Institutional Studies here. Let us start with the origins of our interest to this issue. In 2015, Russian Minister of Education and Science Dmitry Levanov and rector founder of Moscow Management School Pskolkovo wrote a column in Vedomosti newspaper claiming that Russia needs 100 of strong regional universities that are focused on the regional needs, on the regional labor markets. This paper de facto started the so-called the program of so-called regional flagship universities in Russia. You might know about that. They are created by merging by a series of mergers in the Russian regions except St. Petersburg and Moscow. And in this article in particular, they say that unfortunately simple market standpoints about rational economic actor and market equilibrium have not yet replaced proactive education policy anywhere. This is quite interesting because of the opposition that they that making this in this point. It demonstrates the approach to the system design in their aspiration to make the system good and relevant for the state's purposes, for the needs of the society. They're making a hard choice. It is a choice between targeted resource allocation and the belief in the invisible hand of the market. But policy making has limitations, as we all know. And first of all, it's the issue of available instruments for policy making. So they do what they can. Due to the availability of the instruments, the system composition and the system design became the main target of the action. That's why they manage the system by mergers, and in fact the density of the system became the main field of their administration. They say size matters, in this sense the coverage of the network and the extent of competition recedes into the background. But we think that size matters in terms of competition either. Mergers decrease the extent of competition. So how should we consider competition? A simple view would oppose state and market in this sense. But in higher education research and public administration, in higher education research and in public administration literature, we have already a more sophisticated view on this issue. The states now uses more complicated mechanisms regarding competitions in order to achieve policy goals. So managing competition is one of the mechanisms of education policy. In our study, we're making an attempt to look at the competition from the perspective of education policymaking. And this is pretty important for us to make this point, because in our presentation we would focus on all of the issues we're going through in our presentations are determined by this view. So we understand the term competition here, and it is also quite important, as the density of the system. So it is the size and quantity of higher education institutions within the region borders.
Yeah, let me please continue. The presented by Dmitry issue about competition becomes hotter if we deal with such a large systems like Russia. After the crash in the Soviet Union, the system of higher education in Russia has expanded tremendously. It became diversified and heterogeneous system. Partially, it led to the assumption that education policy in such a big country have to take the regional diversity into the account. Universal approach will always be challenged by the different local features and circumstances. It means that even in Russia, where higher education is an issue of federal government, you know that more than 90% of all public universities in Russia are controlled by federal government. In this case, there are several factors that make it possible to consider higher education governance as regional-oriented process. So first of all, I would like to talk about funding. Publicly financed places for the universities are distributed according to the admission quota. The methodology of this quota allocation consists of 20 indicators weighted by several special coefficients. One of these coefficients includes regional factors, which are you can see average level of wages in the regions, and for example coefficients of public utility expenditure. Besides, the higher education applications for the state admission quotas must be approved by the regional authorities. These authorities are supposed to verify those applications in accordance with local labor market needs. The second one point is about cross regional education mobility in Russia, which is really low. The majority of students choose to study in their city or regions of origin where they were born. It means that regional higher education systems in general are characterized by high level of special term closeness in the administrative body. You can see that more than 80% of all entrants in Russia were studied in the city or regions where they were born. And the next one point is about federal and regional authorities' concerns. The diversity of regional higher education system situations attracts attention of both federal and regional authorities. We already mentioned the program of the regional flagship universities. Dmitry said about it. Another federal program about it is, for example, labor forces for the regions, which gave the background for these initiatives. Ministry of Education supported the development and implementation of special education programs and technologies in accordance with main with main priorities of regional development. Some regions points a lot of attention to enhancement of regional higher education systems, even those institutions or universities are not accountable to them. Here you can see just several examples of such projects where regions elaborate special regional strategy of higher education development and supported by special financial provision. Thus we consider regional dimension relevant to investigate competition of universities. The competitive environment in regional higher education systems is reinforced by mentioned earlier funding approaches and closeness of the regional higher education systems. So in our research we consider I would like to mention that in further slides, we mean that competition, we consider the competition for the students, and we will be detailed it further. Yeah.
but as we discussed earlier, competition is not just an idea for policymakers. Their pragmatic ultimate general goal is to promote efficiency in the system. So the question whether or not policy should promote competition is subordinate to the subordinate to the issue of efficiency. In Russia, the given legacy and the some core system features determine the complexity of the picture. So, what is considered good and relevant? It is a complex issue. So we try to to elaborate some perception of efficiency here on the slide, and we will. Personalize it later. Here we can. here we describe three points that, from our perspective, seem to be pretty strong to describe the rationales behind the higher education policy. At least in terms of the issue of competition promotions. Those points are derived from the different priorities of the state, which are complex and which are derived from different ideologies, maybe, and different designs of the social contract between the government and the society. The first one is participation, and we see that socially responsible state would make education accessible for the society, besides just being a response to the some demand, we know that the extent of participation increases human capital and technological development and economic growth. So that's why we take this point as relevant. But it would be fair to admit that Russia has higher education market, and in the system which is not totally state controlled, the market position of a particular university could be measured by the demand. Hence, we take popularity or attractiveness here, which is the point that describes the efficiency of higher education systems. And thirdly, it would be too straightforward for a state to manage and to play only with the quantity of education and not to play with the quality. The legitimacy of state lies upon the quality as well. In our view, those three points describe the current state approach to efficiency. So, first of all, participation. Russian higher education is a mass system, according to Trow definition, with the 36 age cohort participation. But what is relevant and important here that this social responsibility of state is set on the particular judicial documents in the laws. So before 2013 it was here is the ratio, so 170 state-funded students per 10,000 population. Now it's more complicated, but still the responsibility exists. Besides that, not only budget slots are the source for participation, cost sharing, which takes a form of tuition fee paying track, is also considered as a way to boost high participation. So the second one is if we, in order to realize the big picture on efficiency, we take this attractiveness parameter as relevant. We see on this slide that in Russia cross-regional mobility is pretty low, and we compared the ratio of the number of higher education entrants to the number of school graduates, and we see that only 14 regions are attractive higher education systems. And thirdly, regarding quality in higher education, we all know that in 2012, the Minister of Education and Sciences launched this monitoring of higher education institutions' performance, which affected the system pretty much. This performance-driven principles of higher education for institutional activities pushed a great share of the system to the particular kind of behavior. And in general, in this policy, in this measure, we see this managerial approach of the government officials to the system, and it was pretty radical. For example, for 2 years, in 2012-2013, 52 higher education institutions and 373 satellite institutions were reorganized by mergers. Rosobornadzor revoked their licenses. Then even more were planned to close in 2014, from 2014 to 2018. And even private institutions could not avoid reforms. this perception and this focus on quality is pretty important, and we take it into account in our analysis of efficiency.
this whole discussion about competition and efficiency that we try to introduce should bring us to the main research question and the basic question that we want to examine is are efficiency and inter-regional competition interdependent phenomena, are they interrelated? From the theoretical points and previous empirical works, we found that some researchers examine this interrelation for majorly for school systems, secondary school education, and there are some attempts to investigate regional competition and independence with effectiveness in higher education in Italy, and the hypothesis about the existence of this dependence was confirmed there. To contribute to understanding this dependence, we use two methods to operationalize efficiency and competition. Firstly, for efficiency, we use data envelopment analysis approach to estimate efficiency. Usually it is quite popular approach. Usually it is used for estimation of efficiency of the higher education institutions in higher education studies. It is non-parametric approach. The frontier is the calculation of relative score as a distance from a production frontier. Here for higher education, we take two main assumptions, that it is output oriented approach, and that system can influence on the outputs than on the inputs, and that there is a constant return of scale. Secondly, we use Herfindahl-Hirschman index to assess competition level in the in regional higher education. The point is that we use here number of students in one university in the region. It is squared, and then taking the sum of all squared shares in the region. So it is a similar approach to the production spheres, but here the sphere, it is region with the university and size of firm, it is a number of students in university. And here's the parameters that we took for estimation. As we previously discussed about efficiency, there are three output parameters. It is number of students per 10,000 population, it is participation, number of enrolled full-time students per number of school years. It is measure relatively measure attractiveness. And share students that study in low-performing universities according to the monitoring of performance. And as input variable, we take funding of regional higher education system, whole funding including public and private sources that are measured in most regions. They are in average, they are equal, to measure competition, we use normalized number of students. That means that it is not headcount number of students, including part-time students and students on correspondent courses, but there are weighting parameters to count the whole number of students. Here are the illustration what we see when we count competition level and the of the region higher education system. Higher number, higher monopolization in the region, lower number, higher competition in the region. We have quite here's our estimation of correlation, of just correlation about these two parameters. The parameters are comprehensive, but still we can see this not very impressive, but correlation of 34%, and it is significant. And what we can show here that the negative direction confirms our main hypothesis that efficiency and competition level are related in positive way. So with the higher level of competition, the efficiency is increasing. And after some more after developing the idea of the whole idea, we mentioned that there is difference between developing and low performing regions, and as you can see that higher level of in developed regions, the level of competition is high. It is no more than 40%, and so it is very concentrated. But in low-performing regions, the level of competition is diverse. We see that in developing regions, the competition scores differ, and after some estimations, we emphasizes that level of correlation between efficiency scores and competition in low performing regions are higher. It is 45%, and it is significant. Although these results are not really very impressive in terms of the level of competition, but it is the first step to understand the direction of this relationship, and our results, these first results, contain several important issues that we wanted to develop in our further study. In this study, we tried to challenge this universalistic approach to the understanding competition and efficiency. And firstly, we understood that competition and efficiency are not obviously in a position, like it is discussed in policy maker discussions. Secondly, what we wanted to emphasize that context matters, if we look at the developed regions, the measures that promoting restraining competition could have more negative impact than positive. What we want to add more, that we would like to proceed in several directions, develop our ideas, and here are 4 points that we would like to emphasize. That of course our estimation of efficiency is not perfect, but there are lots of approaches to estimate efficiency and take other indicators. And it is the issue for the discussion. of course, we understand that competition of universities are a very comprehensive thing, and that a university compete not only in their regions, although the regions are very close, but universities compete between within some niche, but it is very difficult to identify this niche, and maybe it is one way to develop this idea. Then, of course, the issue of causality between degree of level of competition and efficiency, and we have not still know about the factors that explain this correlation and this relationships. Maybe there are some other factors that should be taken into account as the priority factors. That's all, I think. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you for your presentation. And now, if you have any questions, please, you're welcome.
I would like to ask several questions about competition. And how do you define competition? It seems to me that you can tell us different stories if you investigate competition for state funding, for better students and so on. Do you distinguish competition for different competition or not?
Thank you. frankly, in this very study, we take a very, I would say, simplistic view on this huge issue, and we do understand that it's more like a word than really a concept here. In fact, it would be maybe more relevant to say that we are talking about the density of higher education within regional borders, because so if we look at the what we really counted here, it was the size of the human body of institution and the number of institutions. That's it. So it's very narrow. Narrow view on the how market is constructed, how it is determined, and so we didn't take into consideration the fields of competition, what they are fighting for, actually. So the only thing is their market positions. I would say so. We're not really
Market position, but the ability to attract students. So they compete. We see universities as units that compete for the students, and that's all. As for majority of universities, education activity is the major activity, and they do not compete for other. Grants, research grants, and
right, etc. But sorry for interrupting. But you don't use any measure for, say, selectivity, right?
Yeah.
Because if you use a guess score as a freshman, okay, you can say that the higher the score are, it's more selective. It's mm-hmm. more efficient in terms of campus. Mm-hmm. You don't use it. That's
why we think that we should make some more steps, because mm-hmm. selectivity is one issue. The second issue is the fields of study, because we know that not only universities as entities compete, but it's more like different programs compete for the students. And this makes the picture is very complex, But yeah, we do agree that selectivity is an issue, sure.
Also, it seems to me that your model, your method presumes that university in one region competes only with each other. Yes, and is it so or not? Or maybe you find a way how to take into account that all the even university in Tuva competes with the university in Moscow.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's our basic assumption and limitation. Because, well, the point that we're talking about limitations, so we take this closeness as the factor that defines the competition. Yeah, so it's not it's not really total, and we do understand that, well, the best for example, the segment of best school leavers in terms of exam score would make a choice between some highly selective Moscow universities and maybe the best university in the region, in the whole district. Yeah, that's true, but anyway, this number that we have here is pretty shocking. So we're talking we're talking about this 82% in terms of the describing the picture.
But did you try to exclude Moscow region, Novosibirsk, and did you try?
I guess we did.
And what's
So actually, as I remember, we didn't exclude Moscow and Novosibirsk, but in Moscow there are more than 200 universities in Moscow, and not all of them
universities, small university in Tuva competes with Moscow.
Or big university in Tuva competes with small Moscow.
So it's
you mean from the perspective of college choice or
yes,
but that's kind of another perspective, I guess. So it's the perspective of college choice, and maybe I don't understand the question.
No, it's I guess it is the same, but. Yes, we don't know about the students' choice within what university they choose, even when we are talking about mass segments, not about the elite universities. It is another niche, but there is very large black box because we don't know about within what regions they choose, within what universities, within what fields of study maybe they choose between our university in Tuva for some engineering program and in Moscow for economics and something in private university. Our idea, of course, to, in some future studies, to understand the principles of this student choice and then to map the niches and then to understand the competition. Of course, it is the research for, I guess, several, like maybe years, because we have no data on the student's choice in such detailed way, and it is very difficult to understand the networks of universities. But yes, it is a very relevant point. We just take regions and do not take into account that there are elite universities that can compete on other niche.
offer several questions. First of all, I think that's very interesting and ambitious topic, because first define efficiency, second define their factors, which defines also efficiency across region. It's very important topic, especially for Russian kids. At the same time, I think it should be more justified why we can talk about efficiency on the regional level. Why we can say that two regions in some way compete with each other. To compete, it means that they should be independent of each other, be able to follow their own strategies and have their own resources. From one point of view, that's independent entities. From another point of view, what you're saying is that the government, to a large extent, defined what's going on in the system in general, right? Which questions or the whole issue of independence of regions, right? Because the governance can influence the system in general, so it's not a competition anymore in some sense. So I think there should be some analytical framework presented why we can say that it's competition and what does it mean to compete. That's the first point. It doesn't mean there is no competition, but for me, I was kind of lacking any explanation, especially for international leaders, it should be important.
Excuse me, you mean competition between regions or
right.
between
regions? Why we can say that, so for example, I have two hands, right, just one brain, but two parts, but anyway, one brain. So I can't say that my hands compete for, like, grabbing up food, right? Because I have one brain who decides what hands does what. So in this sense, why we can say that Tuva and say Moldova are independent in the way that they can follow their own strategies, right? Probably they do, but we do need some explanation for that. That's one issue. Another issue is inefficiency. Because when we are talking about the world-class universities, for example, we are saying that the world-class universities are best students, best faculty, best resources. So in some sense, we can say that world-class universities could be the most efficient in some way, like doing research or teaching or something, or probably not. But the way you discuss efficiency is completely another story. It's not about the quality of students, it's not about the quality and the amount of resources, it's not about the faculty. Especially, for example, you're talking about Altai region, right, that there are like very high concentration in the region. I did a small study recently which was totally a different topic, but Altai was also on the top charts of my research. What I did, I took the salary of faculty across different regions and calculated how many international flight tickets you can buy with your salary, right? For example, because in most cases regional faculty need to buy tickets to go for international conference by themselves. So the Moscow is the most rich city, you can buy 5 tickets, like return tickets for your month's salary. But the poorest region was Altai, because for Altai salary, monthly salary, you can just buy one-way ticket to Berlin. So, in some sense, if I would ask whether Altai universities are efficient, I would say from the faculty perspective, no, because they, for sure, I don't know who is working there, but for sure I can say that it's not inefficient in terms of faculty side, because it doesn't provide enough resources for faculty, like to do research, to teach, etc. But from another perspective, from your perspective, it's, say, quite efficient. So I think you need probably to discuss several dimensions of efficiency, and first check whether those dimensions are in the coherent state, whether they all like complement each other. Or you might end up with an idea that there could be different types of efficiency and they complement each other. under rational circumstances. So I think that's important. If we discuss it again, if you take, say, students' perspective and look at the students' quality, that might be totally another story. I also agree that you should probably think a little bit more about, say, Moscow, Tomsk, Krasnoyarsk, and Novosibirsk. And if you don't see them as outliers on your picture, there might be something wrong with the picture itself. Because points of attraction. All right, then about their low level of their interregional ability, which you are talking about. I'm not sure to what extent this interregional mobility, low interregional ability, is explained by the features of the higher education system itself or by some other issues. For example, if you go to Moscow, you can either stay in dorm or you can rent an apartment or something, because there is always an infrastructure around for you. It could be expensive or not, but they offer something. For small regional universities, I'm not sure that they don't have any dorms probably. They don't have any like private sectors for cheap apartments, etc. And they also don't provide, say, medical insurance, social security for those people who move around the region. So that might block the whole idea of mobility even before we talk about the quality of the system. That might be an explanation. Then, again, since that's very interesting and ambitious study, there are many questions which come to mind. And another question is, why people move to another region for getting education? I'm not a specialist in that, but just thinking like 5 minutes about that, I will split all reasons into large groups. First, is that because you can get better quality there. So in your region, you don't get enough quality, you go for quality for another region, okay? And another reason might be for labor perspective. For example, you get the same quality education here, but in another region, you can get better salaries if you get education in another region. Okay? There might be some other explanations why people move, but I think that those are two major ones, right? So I would try to think a little bit more about the question why people don't move, and try to find to what extent it's explained by the issues of the higher education system itself, or by the reasons of labor market, housing, social security, etc. And my final question would be, from the totally different perspective, we all know that today our president spent like several hours answering different questions from the audience, right? So imagine that you have one suggestion from deriving from your paper for their like high level policy making to suggest. What would be your suggestion for, say, Minister for Higher Education or President or whatever? Assuming that they take it into account in the proper way. So what's the policy?
It would be, well, it's hard to I would think,
You can start, I can add something.
I would say talking about the last issue the last question, I would say that the So the direct conclusion that we're making finally that in low performing regions economically, so with low GDP, the extent of competition matters. That's why the policy advice would be to to change the trend from from this correction trend that we're facing about 4 years already, this closing social safes for social lockers for population, and maybe consider it as the important segment of the system, I would say, and maybe to redefine their function in the in higher education system, maybe to give them more symbolic features, as in some other countries, they have this segment which is defined as serving to the special needs of the society. So, what would I advise to the high officials is to reconsider this segment as not diploma meals or something like that, but as a something new. If I have 5 minutes before this advice, I would create something beautiful to call it. So that's it.
Yeah.
I don't know, but the it is hard to. Okay.
Yeah, I just like to say, first of all, thank you very much for this very useful, really, for very useful comments for us and for the further studies. I just would like to say two points. The first one about your first question about competition between regions. So maybe our presentation, I guess that our presentation was not so clear, and maybe we didn't explain it clear, but so we don't focus on competition between regions. We oriented on the competition inside or within regions, and this is
right. But
yeah,
it means that each region has a border, right?
Yes
Which also assumes that there are like they're independent. So
yeah.
What allows you to consider the region as an entity?
This one? Only this one? Yeah. It's a very good question. So I would like to mention something another. So now we have one big international project with Martin Carnoy and another researchers about comparison of federalism in higher education governance. And we have 9 countries, and all these cases are described different relationship between federal and regional authorities in higher education governance. And we see that Russian case, Russian governance models is the most extremely example of highly level of centralization. And all universities, and in this case, all higher education regional systems are controlled by federal. And our colleagues from Canada, Glenn Jones, or from from Germany, Ulrich Teffler, so they mentioned in their article that in these cases regions compete with each other in terms of attract students, some funds and so on, because regions in these cases can't control universities. They have their own programs of development. They have some another instruments how to improve the situations in this territory, and that's why they are talking about competition between regions. In our case, it's really another situation, and so that's why we just on the first view we just want to see inside of the regions, and maybe after that we can just thinking or discuss about can we compete regions between each other and maybe in which segments or niches of higher education can we compare these regions.
I think the question was the
and so on.
What does allow us to talk about the about regions as kind of closed entities? We have 3 points here.
Yeah.
They are not total and they are not striking. The first one is that some of the federal policies consider regional higher education situation and regions as separate entities. So this two funding issues. This funding allocation coefficients, the second one is I don't remember. No. That's it. The second one is this: their closing this low mobility issue. That's kind of. Problematic in terms of what we discussed about mobility. We do agree, and that's the question. We don't have an answer, I would say. And the third one is this. It's not direct, but it could be considered as a signal that some regional authorities. And even federal government are making attempts to consider it as separate entities, without making any changes in terms of the accountability and jurisdiction. This very big. Arguments, maybe an answer. There are some points that let us consider them as a single entity, which doesn't mean that in reality they do act as a single entities and single. As separate players, but if we look on them this way, we are getting these results. So maybe that's the point. And talking about these suggestions, I guess we take all of them. All of them are. Valid and so true. We are thinking on this. We're thinking about this big issue of mapping higher education in Russia because these regional borders are not really relevant in terms of the real design of the system, but it is pretty hard to find those. Maybe college choice is a source of finding, but as we all know, these flows of students are not the only life that happens in the system. So I guess the big question that we're trying to develop and to answer to is what is the, well, the real map of higher education in terms of well, student flows and the money flows, I would say, because there are other things,
graduate distributions.
The flows of graduates and how they're connected with the flows of students, and all of that. But it's too big to even think about, because it's really hard. For example, well, we know a set of facts about that. For example, I don't remember, but three regions, talking about them in administrative wars, take about 75% of the research money, I guess. Moscow, St. Petersburg, Tomsk. What's about others? So, and we know about this issue of part-time education, which is also very important, because we have half of the system part-time. Where do they live, actually? We know about, well, from the from life, that some of them do. Some of them study at the same city they live, and they study part time. So that crushes the idea of part time education. I mean, zaochne correspondence, or how do you call it? So the big way we're trying to hit is this map of higher education. It's kind of a very preliminary attempt to understand what's going on. And we appreciate your comments and suggestions on what we should consider.
Very small question. How would you argue that data development analysis would be a valid tool in your case? Because to my knowledge, that data is used on operation research, and you know strictly mechanism of inputs and outputs, like bulk or by production. How can you apply it to students in university? Because it's not a machine, so it's not bulk.
Yeah.
Actually, in higher education, it is really quite popular, and usually the inputs and outputs are determined, like input is obviously money, government spending, and so on, and output, it is more comprehensive than in industrial research or something like this, and in all attempts, like in ours, we try to conceptualize these outputs, like for the system. It's definitely we do not know about the black box within this, like what is going on with inputs and outputs and the mechanism, like in firms, and it is the limitation, of course, but unfortunately there is no any other there is no other way to understand efficiency for public sector and for higher education as to just take some examples from market economy and to use it here. That's why I couldn't argue that it is the ideal method, but it is one of the we are lacking in methods to understand efficiency of universities, for example, and of course for the system as we take it. We just look at it from the mathematical point, like it is, yes, it is inputs and outputs and black blocks in there.
Yes, but in this case it's not clear what is measured.
What
you measure with this efficiency estimate, it's not clear, because different territories, different universities, and even with the same coverage, they would produce one university would produce high quality students and competitive with the job market, the other university would produce garbage.
So firms are different?
Firms that have produced unified balls according to standards, that the balls are equal, or cars, perhaps. You can define the standard. How can you define the standard?
So you mean what they produce?
Yes.
Well, it's a kind of...
I guess we have standards, which is in the law, for example, the number of students.
The question is, a university produces a lot of things, mm-hmm. right? And it's not like one... well, that's true, but...
I guess the question is the issue that there is no standards for the outputs.
Yeah.
So it's not different things, but it is different quality, I guess. But in firms, for example, for cars, there is no standard for the cars. The cars can differ.
There are classes of cars that you can compare. It's not easy to compare, but it's not easy to compare the person. And it's not the same to produce a student from HEC, and it's not the same student from some regional
university. So actually, I can say that from the point of public administration or federal authorities, they can find standards for all of these outputs. The first one outputs, which is described in the law on education. The first one is about the policy of regional flagship universities, which should do to keep and to attract school leaders from this territory in the universities in these regions, and ministry said about it. And the last one is it's just monitoring with explicit rules, with explicit thresholds of performance and so on. In this case, I guess it can be considered as
standard.
I guess
as standards, yeah.
I guess you're arguing with the all of this NPM, new public management approach. Well, that's kind of another discussion, I would say, because maybe it's not appropriate to measure universities like this, but people do. So that's it. We're not the first who made it. Jill Jones from the UK is kind of making 10 papers a year about this. Agassisti is very famous.
Did it for the
Italy.
For Tegic as well. So the big issues here is should we whether or not it is appropriate to consider public entities as firms. Yes, that's an issue, but it's a kind of basic assumption that we made. Let's do it. So not every day, but
there any other questions?
Still, I think this discussion, it's not exactly the critique of new public management, which is too big to be criticized. We're not that but I think to their non-precise definition again of what you measure, what you suggest is inefficiency. Because I think another concern is that, and everybody points it out, that this monitoring of hydrants is very imperfect measure of efficiency. So mm-hmm. even if we define efficiency in the way you do, still this technique is very, say, unperfect for measuring that. Because it's not produced within the system, it's very unperfect way from above to catch something mm-hmm. what was going on in the system.
Yes, that's true. What we were starting from is this. So we are arguing not with the with the. So we are not claiming that everything should be so transparent and measured by the universal indicators and so on. Our basic point was to argue with the actually officials who are making universalistic decision regarding the whole system. In this sense, we're contributing to the critical view on new public management, because those decisions on mergers. So this monitoring of institutional performance, they actually they changed the system because they closed a lot of regional institutions, and mergers and this reorganization they changed they influenced social life, what we are trying to say that by making mergers, you make the system different, because competition matters, at least in the low performing economically. In the region that are low performing in terms of their GDP.
Yes, but let's look at that at a little bit different perspective. You are saying that the government officials, they propose very universal approach, which is not good because you should somehow differentiate these differences.
But we do the same. Mm-hmm. But we do the same.
In some sense, yes. Because, let's ask a question, why we can't do that? Why they offer such a universal approach? And probably the answer, very simple answer, would be because they don't see any difference. Because to differentiate between something, you should see the difference between institutions, right? And what they do, they have this monitoring, which basically demonstrates that everybody is more or less efficient, in some sense. Okay? We have some conservatories which are not efficient. We do have some like art institutions which are not efficient, but in general, most of them are efficient. And I think that the main problem with the government approach is that the government feels that there is something wrong with the system. And many mm-hmm. institutions are not efficient, but they don't have any valid instruments to measure that, right? To find them. So what they're trying desperately to do is to impose some universal approach, not because they are that stupid, but just because they don't understand what's going on. And if you want to mm-hmm. criticize that, I think that the best way to tackle with that is say, okay, here's an approach you should use instead of yours. Mm. And what is, I think, lacking in your research mm-hmm. is that you're showing that, look, there is a map, everything is complicated, don't be so straightforward, that's perfectly fine, but you don't offer anything which can substitute their strategy. And until you do that, they will always follow the previous approach because they should do something, right? So I think that, like, policy questions would be how we should we substitute this universal approach with another approach based on understanding the differences, inefficiencies, and returns, etc. Then everybody would be happy.
I agree totally, but I guess we're making very some very tiny points on that. The first one is that actually monitoring is measuring is not measuring efficiency, it's measuring performance, and they do not consider the money they gave them, the context these institutions are situated in, so one of the again tiny point that we're trying to make that efficiency maybe is more relevant than just performance, and maybe the second one, which is not very clear, that in the regions with the hard economic not so good economic circumstances, those decisions should be they should think twice before they do something, not because of the social risks, but also because of the for those regions the number of institutions they have matters from this perspective, from with these limitations. But I do agree totally that we do not offer something new for them.
By the way, did you look on the wage premium across regions? Can you claim that for say four regions, wage premium from higher education is more important than for just look at that.
Wait, try.
Yeah. And we see that for low performing regions, for example, Tava, it's really good example. The
our favorite.
our favorite example. So the first one interesting point that in these regions more than 50% of all students are studied on the pedagogic programs, and they just provide staff for the social sector of these regions. The first one point that the people who study in these universities, who employed in these universities, I guess maybe it's about 3 or 4% of all people which employed in these regions, and this is really big figure in comparison with different regions, and the level of wages in these regions are bigger than in some another region, I guess. So
Tuva is an example, but do we have some kind of estimation on this?
Yeah, we do it now.
Okay. So it's work in progress.
Yeah.